If you look back over the last 3 decades or so, you'll see that much of the growth in inequality has in fact come from events in the labour market. Given these rather adverse events that have happened to the low-skilled and low-educated, how could policy best be designed to address this in the most reasonable way? And it's not just the policy challenges, they're the key, of course, to driving this research, but the excitement is also around the enormous expansion of data available to investigate how families and individuals evolve during their lifetime in the labour market. This is what we call a microdata revolution. What we can do is then bring in their savings, their training, their education, what's happening with their children, and put a complete picture together of family incomes. How do we think about the trade-offs between welfare policy, tax credit policy, which are so important in a way as policies, versus the minimum wage? We've seen some thinking that suggests these are substitutes, kind of alternatives, that, oh well, we've been relying too much on tax credits and really we should be increasing the minimum wage. To me, this is the wrong way of thinking about it. We should think about minimum wage and welfare and tax credits rather complementary policies. We found using this data that there really is a large increase in the inequality of male earnings. It's a surprising detachment from the labour market and reduction of hours among lower educated men. And another reason why the minimum wage can be less effective, because although it might support the hourly wage, if hours are not making up sufficient number, then of course earnings won't rise. And we see an increase in earnings inequality at the same time as wages are being propped up at the bottom of the distribution in the UK, which really pinpoints to this importance of earnings and hours and the trade-off of minimum wage and other policies.